What we're trying to do in the book is always like really distill the value of therapy. Like why spend
Yeah.
your money on therapy? Why not spend it on massage or a holiday or European mini break or whatever else? It's an expensive business getting to therapy. And I suppose trying to also encourage therapists to think about why them. What is it that's special about them? What's the value that they add? My feeling is that therapists sometimes can be a bit too modest about what it is they bring to the party. So the book was trying to describe just how effective therapy is, and primarily from the for the clients to be useful to clients, to let them know that they're getting into something which is likely to help them in most instances. But also, I think for therapists to know that what they're doing is really highly valuable. The book tries to describe that in a way that other books do the same kind of thing. I was thinking of Wompold's book, like The Great Psychotherapy Debate, which people probably know, but it's a monster of a book. It's really dense. So it was trying to just trying to make that evidence base, I suppose, as clear as possible. We see therapists emphasizing things like confidentiality or offering a safe space, and that's all well and good, but therapy does, it does a bit more than that as well. Those are sort of those are the basics, but it's really and from our point of view, life-changing experience as well. And sometimes I think it gets sold a bit short. So some of the book was trying to say, hey, there's this thing that really seems to help lots of people with lots of problems most of the time.
And so, because most of us won't have read the book, can you give us a couple of examples of how you would say therapy has helped people
Yeah, sure.
read
So,
the book?
I think, I think it might be worth just like 30 seconds on the scale of the problem as well. So, the World Health Organization estimates that mental health problems account for something like 40% of all illnesses. And that's like up against things like strokes, cancer, heart disease, lung disease, diabetes. All of those things together account for less than 20% of overall ill health. So it's a huge kind of deal. In the US, more people end their own lives than are killed in road traffic accidents. In the UK, something like 40% of GP appointments now have a mental health component to them. So it's a huge problem. And then what people say about therapy, those who've experienced therapy when they're surveyed. So there's a fairly recent YouGov survey, big number of people surveyed. 75% of people who'd had therapy said that they would recommend it to a friend. And that's a pretty high satisfaction rate because you are spending quite a lot of money. You are telling a stranger your deepest, darkest secrets. There's some survey research from the US, which is a bit older than that, which is an even higher satisfaction rate. Something like 90 plus percent of people are satisfied with their experiences of therapy. So I think just trying to get that over to people that this isn't quite such a risk. It's probably a worthwhile investment of your time and money. And the big reviews, like the Wompold Review of Psychotherapy Research, which sort of takes place over multiple decades, finds that psychotherapy is more effective than almost all interventions in cardiology, and more effective even than the flu vaccine. And I think that doesn't get spoken of enough. That wasn't part of my initial training. We weren't saying to people, hey, this is a highly effective thing. In simple terms, three quarters of people who've had therapy end up in a better state of emotional health, than those with comparable mental health challenges who don't have therapy. We tend to emphasize safe spaces. We tend to emphasize confidentiality, but actually the improvements show up in really practical ways, like the number of hours slept per night. There was an interesting study, which is in the book somewhere, I can't remember where, around anorexia. So clients with anorexia weighed on average 8 kilograms more after 12 months of therapy. That's a really practical, literally life-saving effect.
Now your government sorry, your background in government's kind of clear from the way you're describing things. You're talking about analytics and outcomes and things that, as you say, are often not spoken about when people talk about the evidence for therapy. Can you tell everybody a bit more about how the two of you come together and what sort of backgrounds you have?
Yeah, without boring people too much, I'll go quickly, Graham, and then maybe you'll jump in. So we both worked in central government, so government's kind of made up of a mix of political advisors and then civil servants who tend to give advice on operational matters, on the detail, on kind of technical issues, give legal advice, for example. And the idea is that that's objective, that it's impartial, and that's the kind of thing we did. And for all the flaws of government, and they are many and various, governments trying to solve some of the toughest problems facing society, and when it works well, when it works as it should, it's drawing on data and evidence to make decisions about where to spend public money, and you don't have to look very far to see where those decisions go wrong and to kind of critique that approach. And in the end, I suppose that is partly why we left, not always decisions being made on that basis of impartial objective evidence. But that was really what we did. Our job was to assemble evidence, make recommendations. And we've tried to do a similar thing, I suppose, with the book in terms of what Graham was talking about up front, the therapy being complex, there being lots of different schools of therapy. Some people estimate more than 500 different types of therapy. Even when you go on a resource like yours, Louise, you're confronted with all those different choices. How on earth do I make sense of what all of these different things are? It's really confusing and baffling for people. So it was trying to simplify that so that the kind of general client could understand that and could make sense of why there were quite so many types of therapy and why there are so many different types of people. Like, what's a psychoanalyst? What's a psychotherapist? What's a therapist? Is a therapist a psychotherapist and a counselor, or is a counselor a bit different? What's this coach thing we're talking about? Do I need a psychologist? Do I need a psychiatrist? What even is a psychiatrist? You know, those kinds of things that I think are genuinely baffling, even for really smart, sophisticated clients who know their way around the world when it comes to mental health. I think it is all a bit, it's a bit mysterious.
The book talks about good and bad therapy. Graham, how would you define that? Both, either?
I think it's less about how I would define it, more about how others have defined it in terms of what does the evidence suggest is the kind of core components of good therapy. And if I was to give you a kind of 30-second distillation of what the research suggests is good therapy, what one, there maybe three pillars to it. One is, what does the research show might help this client at this particular time? The second is client preferences. What's the personality of the client? What would they prefer? Are they the type of person that wants an interventionist, active therapist that's going to be setting them work outside of sessions, or do they prefer the space to kind of access their own feelings and to make sense of their own feelings? The third thing is then the skill of the therapist. And I guess the skill of the therapist combines all of those elements, right? So they're constantly thinking about, what does this particular client need? What does the research suggest is potentially best for this client, if there is any research, just to try and answer that question. But then, of course, there's the empathetic relational part of it. So is the therapist good at getting a connection with that particular client and clients more generally? So it's those kind of three factors that combine to make the best kind of therapy. And inevitably, kind of bad or mediocre therapy is the kind of flip side of that coin. So instead of targeting or understanding what the research and evidence base suggests might be helpful for that particular client, you take a much more broad approach, and you think that because I'm trained in a certain type of therapy that I've been told can fix anyone's problems at any time, you go into the work with that mindset, that very rigid mindset of saying, okay, CBT will help absolutely everyone at all time, or Freudian psychoanalysis will help absolutely everyone at any time. And that's that. The research suggests that's just not the case, that there are certain types of mental health problem where a certain type of therapy can be particularly useful, but more generally, it's more based on the client preferences and the skill of therapist. I think in terms of how we as therapists can kind of make use of that research base, my mind always goes to, well, we can in some ways relax a little bit, because we're so we're so determined to, in many ways, to stick to our school of therapy and our school of thought and to try and crowbar everything into it, that actually what we're saying is, no, maybe I'll be able to support and help a wide range of clients, but maybe there'll be times where I have to refer elsewhere. If I'm checking in with the client's preferences, if I'm seeking from minute one and session one to connect with this client, and I'm confident and I'm seeking feedback on that approach, both from the client themselves and from my supervisors and peer colleagues, et cetera, so that I'm continually trying to improve my skill as a therapist. You can do a lot on those quite simple, those simple principles of good therapy.